Dear friends, this is episode number 72 of the Limitation Act. We are continuing with the adverse possession subject. And in the last episode, I cited a decision of the Supreme Court. Just diverted the discussion to pristine Hindu law, etc., etc. This decision is AER 1966 Supreme Court 470. MVS Manikkayala Rao. Manikkayala Rao versus M. Narasimha Swami and others. M. Narasimha Swami and others. Article 144, which corresponds to Article 65 of the 1963 Act. No adverse possession of co-parsoners as long as there is no partition. Paragraph 5. As earlier stated, the High Court held that Article 144 applied. The application of this article seems to us to present great difficulties, to some of which we like to refer. The article deals with a suit for possession of immoral property or an interest therein not otherwise specifically provided for, and prescribes a period of 12 years commencing from the date when the possession of the defendant becomes adverse to the plaintiff. This article obviously contemplates a suit for possession of the property where the defendant might be in adverse possession of it as against the plaintiff. Now, it is well settled that the purchaser of a co-parsoner's undivided interest in joint family property is not entitled to possession of what he has purchased. His only right is to sue for partition of the property and ask for allotment to him of that which on partition might be bound to fall to the share of the co-parsoner whose share he had purchased. His right to possession would date from the period when the specific allotment was made in his favor. See, what is this? A co-parsoner transfers his undivided interest. The transferee will not get that right at that time. He cannot get joint possession. He cannot enter into the co-parsonry property. He cannot join family house and live along with the other members of the joint family. The jointness will disrupt then. A stranger comes. We do not know who he is. So that the law is that the alienation by the co-parsoner will not cloth with the alienee, that is the transferee, a right to immediate possession. He can only ask for partition of that share. And what is the importance of a co-parsoner's right? It fluctuates. By the birth of a male member in the joint family, I am saying about 1956, before 1956. After 1956, exceptions are there. That is contained in Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act, etc. Otherwise not. Now, what is the speciality of Hindu co-parsonry, Hindu law? That is joint Midaksha co-personary. By birth, the share of the co-personers diminished. Share decreases. And by death, it increases. A male member is born. Suppose there are 100 members in the co-parsonry. Why a male child is born, it becomes 101. So each member is entitled to 1 by 101. Suppose 5 persons die, it becomes 96. Then the share increases by 1 by 96. So it is a fluctuating thing. So a stranger cannot claim adverse possession against on the basis of a transfer or alienation or any other arrangement made by a co-parsoner. He cannot get at the property except by filing a suit for partition. That is what this would date from the period when the specific allotment was made in his favor. and that is a decision of the Supreme Court, which is referred to here, Siddheshwar Mukherjee versus Bhumineshwar Prasad, Narayan Singh, AER 1953 Supreme Court 487 at 491. It would therefore, now we come back to the, this reference is made, come back to MVS Manikayala Rao. It would therefore appear that Shivayya was not entitled to possession till a partition has been made. Shivayya is an alienee. That being so, it is arguable that the defendants in the suit could never have been in adverse possession of the properties as against him, as possession could be adverse against a person only when he was entitled to possession. Shivayya was the co-personer. I committed a mistake. Shivayya was the co-personer. He could not say not entitled to possession till a partition has been made. Independent possession he cannot have. Support from this view may be found in some of the observations of the Madras High Court full bench case in Vyapuri versus Somanna Boy Ammani. That is AER 1916 Madras 990 full bench. So at that time, those years, there were a lot of litigation touching upon Hindu law. Now it is not there. Very rare. Because the laws changed. Now, next heading, possession of mortgagee. What is the nature of possession vis-a-vis adverse possession? Possession of mortgagee. Please note a decision. AER 1963 Supreme Court 70. Three judges. Padma Vithoba Chakkayya. Versus Muhammad Multani and another. Article 144, para 7. It is not disputed that when a person gets into possession of properties as mortgagee, he cannot, by any unilateral act or declaration of his, prescribe for a title of by adverse possession against the mortgagor, because in law, his possession is that of the mortgagor. See, I am the owner of the property. I borrowed money from you and I mortgaged the property in your favor. So I am the mortgagor, you are the mortgagee. You are put in possession, possessory mortgage. Your possession is attributable to the mortgage as that of a mortgagee. You cannot prescribe title by adverse possession against me so long as the mortgage continues. That is it. He cannot by any unilateral act or declaration of his prescribe for a title by adverse possession against the mortgagor, because in law his possession is that of the mortgagor. But what is contended is that the mortgagor and the mortgagee subsequently entered into a transaction under which the mortgagee is to hold the properties thereafter, not as a mortgagee, but as owner. That would be sufficient to start adverse possession against the mortgagor if the transaction is for any reason inoperative under the law. This contention, in our opinion, is well founded. Though there was at one time a body of judicial opinion that when a person enters into possession as a mortgagee, he cannot under any circumstances acquire a title by prescription against the owner, the law is now fairly well settled that he can do so where there is a change in the character of his possession under an agreement with the owner. A Madras decision was followed. AER 1921, Madras 82 was relied on. So, a mortgage is always a mortgage. Once a mortgage, always a mortgage is the theory. But a mortgagee, usually he cannot prescribe title by adverse possession against the mortgager, so long as the mortgage continues. Suppose there is a further future arrangement under which the character of the mortgage comes to an end, that is the mortgagee ceases to be a mortgagee and he acquires some other right, or not a derivative right, but he becomes a stranger or something like that, then he continues in possession. That possession may become adverse, depends on the facts of each case. But the change in law has been noted. So please read that judgment. Then next heading, permissive possession, referable to a valid contract. Permissive possession hyphen referable to a valid contract. Please note a decision, 1994 SEC 706, AER citation, AER 1990, Supreme Court 553, Achal Reddy versus Ramakrishna Reddiar and others. This decision has been cited and followed in hundreds of decisions, even of the Supreme Court and of various high courts. Achal Reddy's case. The principles have been well settled there. Article 64 and 65, all those things paragraph 8, 9 are long paragraphs. The point decided here, executory contract of sale, an agreement of sale, and under that agreement he obtains, a party obtains possession. And thereby he what does what? He acknowledges title of the vendor, even though agreement of sale may be valid, may be not valid. Acknowledgement and recognition of title of the vendor, which excludes the theory of adverse possession. Purchaser who gets into possession under an executory contract of sale is in a permissible character, cannot be heard to contend that his possession was adverse. In the conception of adverse possession, there is an essential, etc., etc. It is paraite, it is well settled rule of that rule of law is that if a person is in actual possession and has a right to possession under a title involving a due recognition of the owner's title, his possession will not be regarded as adverse in law, even though he claims under another title having regard to the well recognized policy of law that possession is never considered adverse if it is referable to a valid title. So if it is, the possession is referable to a valid title, it can never be treated as adverse. The purchaser who got into possession under an executory contract of sale in a permissible character cannot be heard to contend that his possession was adverse. In the conception of adverse possession, there is an essential and basic difference between a case in which the other party is put in possession of the property by an outright transfer, both parties stipulating for a total divestiture of all the rights of the transferor in the property, and in case in which there is a mere executory agreement of transfer, both parties contemplating a deed of transfer to be executed at a later point of time. That is executory contract. An agreement by which the parties enter an agreement to execute the sale later. In the latter case, the principle of estoppel applies, estopping the transferee from contending that his possession while the contract remains executory in stage. was on his own right and adversely against the transferor. Adverse possession implies what is commenced in wrong and what is maintained against right. When the commencement and continuance of possession is legal and proper, referable to a contract, it cannot be adverse. The principle is that it commences in wrong and it is aimed at right. So in the case of an executory contract, the possession of the transferee is legal. It is under a color of title. It is as per the agreement. The entry into the property was as per a legal process, as per a lawful agreement. He cannot convert it into, he cannot say that that possession is referable to an adverse possession. He cannot. In the case of an executory contract of sale, para 9, where the transferee is put in possession of the property in pursuance of an agreement of sale, and where the parties contemplate the execution of a regular registered sale deed, the animus of the purchaser throughout is that he is in possession of the property belonging to the title holder has to be perfected by duly executed registered deed of sale, under which the vendor has to pass on and convey his title. The purchaser's possession in such cases is of a derivative character and in clear recognition of and in acknowledgement of the title of the vendor. The possession is different in the case where in pursuance of an oral transfer or a deed of transfer not registered, the owner of a property transfers the property and puts the transferee in possession with the clear animus and on the distinct understanding that from that time onwards he shall have no right or title in the property. In such a case, the owner of the property does not retain any vestige of right in regard to the property, and his mental attitude towards the property is that it has ceased to belong to him altogether. The transferee, after getting into possession, retains the same with a clear animus that he has become an absolute owner of the property and in complete negation of any right or title of the transferor. His enjoyment is solely as owner of the right and not derivatively or in recognition of a title of another person. This distinction you have to, so far as the vendor is concerned, both in mind and actual, so and so. Executory contract and an outright sale, even if it is invalid. These are all the aspects to be noted. Achal Reddy was referred to in various decisions. Please read the Achal Reddy's decision in full. You will get a good idea as to what adverse possession is. Next is 2002 2ACC 612. AER 2002 Supreme Court 812. Moolchand Bakru, BAKHRU, Moolchand Bakru and another versus Roshan and others. Part performance 53A of the Transfer of Property Act. And the principles of adverse possession are all discussed. Then paragraph 4. I will read only that paragraph 4, one sentence, and paragraph 9. Paragraph 4 is a big paragraph, last sentence. Alternatively, it was pleaded that the respondents acquired title to the property in dispute by way of adverse possession as they were continuing in possession since 1968. The claim of appellants for mean profits was denied. Para 9. The High Court, relying upon a judgment of this court in Mohanlal versus Mirza Abdul Ghaffar, 96.1 SEC 639, I had cited this judgment, came to the conclusion that since the respondents were claiming to be in possession of the property in part performance of an agreement to sell, the plea of acquisition of title by adverse possession was not available to them. Learned counsel appearing for the respondents did not assail this finding of the High Court. The view expressed in Mohanlal Kachru versus so and so has been reiterated by this court in Roop Singh versus Ram Singh, 2000, volume 3, SCC 708. It has been held in the latter judgment that the pleas of adverse possession and retaining the possession by operation of section 53A are inconsistent with each other. Such plea is not available to a proposed vendee. I am the owner. I enter into an agreement for sale of my property with you. I received advance, almost 75% of the consideration I received in advance. And I put you in possession of the property. You can claim part performance and your possession is referable to that. And even if you have got a 3 years period to file a suit for specific performance, I also got the same 3 years time to normally, but exceptions are there, to file a suit. The period of limit, let us take it that period of limitation is provided for filing a suit for specific performance. That period is over. So possession is with you. You are in possession of the property in part performance of the agreement to sell. You can protect that possession, no harm. But it cannot be adverse possession. It cannot be adverse possession because your possession is referable to a valid contract. That is a contract of sale. You are put in possession in part performance of the contract. So your possession is always referable to, unless you have abandoned that character and started possession adversely to me, to my knowledge, openly. That so long as that does not take place, your possession is always referable to a valid contract, which can never be adverse. Then another decision of the Supreme Court, Mohanlal, that is, which is referred to in the earlier decision, which I cited, Moolchand. Mohanlal, 96-1 SCC 639, AER citation, AER 1996 Supreme Court, 910, Mohanlal through LRs Kachru and others versus Meera Abdul Ghaffar and another. Meera Abdul Ghaffar and another. That is referred to there, we have discussed this, therefore it is not necessary. Paragraph 4, that principle has been stated. Next is a Kerala decision, ILR 2008, 1 Kerala, 723. It is reported in Kerala Law Times also, 2008, 1 KLT 719. That was a decision rendered by me. Devasi versus Koratti Grama Panchayat. Devasi versus Koratti Grama Panchayat. That was under the Land Conservancy Act, Kerala. Possession was there, long period. It was permissive possession. And there was a provision for paying prohibitory assessment. In this case, that person paid prohibitory assessment. And even thereafter, he claimed adverse possession. That adverse possession was negatived. Payment of prohibitory assessment by the unauthorized occupant amounts to subpara 8. Payment of prohibitory assessment by the unauthorized occupant amounts to submitting to the right and title of the government. It cannot be said that the person concerned retains animus possidendi even after paying the prohibitory assessment. had the plaintiff perfected his title by adverse possession at the time of issuing Exhibit A3, that document, prohibitory, there was no necessity for him to have paid the prohibitory assessment. See the interpretation. He paid the prohibitory assessment, thereby admitted the title, paramount title of the government, and admitted that he is continuing under a wrongful entry and he is paying prohibitory assessment. That means he wants to continue by paying that prohibitory assessment. But that does not have the color of adverse possession. The plea of adverse possession on the one hand and the plea of permissive possession on the other, or any other nature of possession on the basis of license or permission on the other, would not go together. Plea of adverse possession on the one hand and the plea of permissive possession would not go together. Once it is established that possession of the person concerned is attributable to a permission or a license or any other sort of grant or assent, the character of such possession would not turn to be adverse possession unless the person concerned establishes that he had shed his character under which he was holding the land and started possessing the property adversely with all the necessary ingredients of adverse possession. So many decisions were referred to and followed in that judgment. Please go through it. And I think time is running out. We will see in the next episode. Thank you.